maybe somebody who can do some tech stuff. So you can just deliver them. Don't have to wait till Christmas. Could be an early present. I'm okay with that. There is something that, are we rolling? Thank you. There is something that I need you to know because we are a registered nonprofit organization and we take donations and give tax receipts. So two things that I need to tell you. One of them is that if you want to have any of your gifts recorded by the end of the year, we have to have those dated by December 31st. So if you're going to write a check, what's that? And in the office. So if you're going to write a check, you can date it as late as December 31st. And it needs to be in our office no later than December 31st. And you'll get credit by the end of the year. If it comes in after that, you'll get credit on the following year. Does that make sense? I have to tell you that. If you have been considering any sort of year-end gift, I know that a lot of us look at their finances and say they want to give a year-end gift to a nonprofit like this, that would be falling in that category that's got to come by the end of the year. The second thing that I have to tell you about that is you will receive your year-end giving statement for year 2021. You'll receive that by the end of January 2022. Because we have 4 weeks to get it. Okay? That's down on the way. Hey, everybody. It's a great day. It's not raining. It's sunshining. My microphone is working. It's a fantastic morning. And it is a great week. It is Christmas week. Did you know that? Did you know that this Saturday is Christmas? So, Mike, you better get out of your job today. No, not yet. You got to get 4 days. Okay. I don't really know. Roger's like, hey, you can come with me. I'm going on the 24th. That's more deals.
Stop giving away our secrets.
That's the truth. Well, I am so glad to see you guys today. I am excited about this day. I think, if I remember right, Linda told me last week that I had to call on Linda before we could continue. So I'll do that now.
Here is a microphone.
Hey, Elise. Elise. She's still up there. She's down. Yeah, it's muted. So it's all right. We got another one. No, I'll just take care of it.
Just in case you're really getting a hold of me.
Oh, yeah, that was a story. That was a cool paper.
Yes.
We'll be meeting here this certain day.
And that's for Lizzie.
And there's Mountain Dew. And Pepsi. And all kinds of things in there.
There's one for Addie.
Yeah, I'm kidding.
That's awesome.
That is fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
We'll hold the rest of that
later.
Because it will take too long.
This is awesome. Thank you all so much.
It has been a difficult year.
And I'll go
with this one.
It has been a difficult year.
It's been a difficult couple of years.
But I have really enjoyed seeing how God has carried us through.
And every time I think that there's nothing left to give, you give something else to give.
And that's been good.
I think that's kind of a lot of what the church is for.
It's just for us to stick together and stick close to Him and see where He leads us.
So that's fantastic.
And I'm glad you all stuck together.
I know that many have dropped off in the last couple of years for whatever reason.
But He has drawn us together.
And He says, draw near to Him and draw near to us.
That's what we're going to do.
So this morning we will be singing some Christmas songs.
Yes. I know there's a little more music than normal,
but when you tell me there's Christmas songs, I only have like five weeks.
So we've got to get them in there.
So that's really good.
I'm enjoying that as well.
And just very thankful
to be here with you today.
So, yes.
Oh, yes, I will do that.
Okay, yes.
So Christmas schedule.
So Christmas Eve is Friday.
And we're having an awesome Christmas Eve service.
Some of you came to a Christmas Eve service we had last year.
It was much more interactive.
It was kind of a walkthrough service.
We'll be doing something very similar this year.
Everybody just loved it and wanted to do something like that again.
So you definitely want to be here for Christmas Eve.
That starts at 4 o'clock.
You don't have to be here at the stroke of 4 o'clock.
You come and you walk through it.
You stop, pray, read some things, and try to get a little bit of an experience of Christmas.
So sometime between 4 and 6, you want to come and do that.
You can get through it as little as 15 minutes or as much as 45 minutes,
depending on how you want to work on that.
But you definitely want to be part of that.
If there's somebody that you've been wanting to invite,
it's a great opportunity to invite them
because there's no protracted preaching.
There's no uncomfortable congregational singing.
None of those kinds of things.
It's just an opportunity to come and reflect on what Christmas is,
on what it really matters so much to us.
So that's a fantastic opportunity.
It really is a neat time.
I strongly suggest you come and bring people on the 24th, starting at 4 o'clock.
And then know that this Wednesday there's Bible study.
Okay.
Know that there's no Bible study this Wednesday.
Or next Wednesday.
And does that completely change the schedule?
And then what's that?
And no youth group on Thursday, of course,
because there's no school.
And then youth group Christmas party tonight at 6.
So that's what we got going on.
No Sunday school next week.
That's right.
Doug says that he's really excited to get out of Sunday school.
Okay, let's pray.
Lord, how we thank you that we can be together today.
And we thank you now that the business we needed to do is done,
that we can turn our hearts and minds to you.
We have not come here to celebrate one another.
Or even to enjoy one another as much as we do enjoy being together.
We have come here to be with you.
To come together corporately, all of us as one,
and be with you.
We thank you, Lord, that we are not limited to just this time in your presence.
But how we thank you for this time in your presence.
And we pray, Lord, that today we would hear directly from you.
That in our singing we would worship you. That in our giving we would surrender to you.
We would bow before you and crown you King.
We thank you.
In Jesus' name.
Good morning, singers. We begin with a couple of Christmas carols.
Oh, Love, this overused and misunderstood word has been understood in you for centuries. Poets and preachers, thinkers and teachers have dissected love in all its original forms, yet even with so much etymological and linguistic understanding, love is still a difficult concept. Loving well is hard, receiving love, especially when it has full hurt, can also be hard. Yet Christ wants to teach us about his love. What is love according to the Bible? In one word, the incarnation. When Jesus was born in conversion, God took on him in place of flesh for the purpose of dying a final death to redeem humanity and all of the created order from the grip and consequences of sin, death, and doubt. This is love in its truest, highest, and purest form. God loves the people he created so much that he sent his son Jesus to die so that we could live. Today marks the fourth week of Advent, a season recognized by the church around the world as a time to prepare our hearts and lives to welcome the coming of Jesus Christ at Christmas. We track this season by engaging in several rhythms, one of them being to light candles, one for each week leading to Christmas Day. Today we light the fourth candle, traditionally called the candle of love.
It's a praise we prepare to give. Lord, we thank you that you have given everything that you are for us. And you did it with whole, even your Son. You did it with whole, the glory of heaven. And you came humbly. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us a way to identify with you as we bow before you humbly and open our hands to you. We thank you, Lord, that you make it possible. And pray that as we give, even now, that it would be out of compulsion of duty, that out of a sense of joy, that we can identify with you in this way, and that doing this allows us to be free from the things of the world, so that we can just rest in you. How we thank you, Lord, for your constant provision and care. In Jesus' name, amen.
an opportunity for us as a family to get together and pray. I've told you many times the altars are always open and available, as well as where you are, the front row. Some of the Spanish congregation are right out of the aisle and lay flat on the floor. Whatever you got to do, now is the time for you to come and present yourself to Him. You don't have to be silent. You can call out to Him. And I know I'm the only one with a microphone, but believe me, He can hear. So now is an opportunity for you to get together and pray. Take a moment, get yourself ready, and then pray.
To explain to the insurance company.
when he tells me that these were supposed to be 8-hour hymns. I think what that means is that if you try to leave them running for 8 hours, you'll burn your church down. I think that's what that means. No, it's just fine. Well, Whitney is lighting those. If you would take your Bible and turn to Romans 8, I told you we're going to be in Romans 8 for a while, and we just will. It's really one of the most fantastic chapters in all of the Bible. We will have the next few sermons out of Romans chapter 8, and then when we get back after the beginning of the year, we'll be in Romans chapter 8 for another couple of Wednesday nights, and we might roll back over some of the things we've already discussed and then bring them up again. Katrina was telling me that when she went to school, she went to private school before going to Christian school, her teachers had to memorize Romans chapter 8. And I had suggested that one Wednesday night, and I still suggest memorizing Romans chapter 8 would be such a bad thing. I can't say I've got the whole thing memorized. I've got various verses in there stuck in my head, but it would be a bad idea to memorize the whole thing. Martin Luther made his congregation memorize all of Romans, so I think I could probably handle it. I have written down that I'm going to read it for you from Romans 8, chapter 8, verses 12 through 17, but I'm actually going to back up and start right at the beginning of the chapter and read through verse 17 today. Romans 8, I'm going to be reading out of the NIV this morning. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they don't belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation. But it's not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you can live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption into sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are God's children, then we are heirs, heirs of God, and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. Let's stop and pray. Lord, we thank you for this magnificent section of scriptures. Just no way we could profess to understand it all in one quick setting. But what we read in there, Lord, is that you have given us life and you have made us your children, not by anything we've done, but by your grace. And so we thank you and we believe it and we take you at your word and we are your children. Teach us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. It'll be a couple of Wednesdays before we really get into this section. What a great verse. Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. You might have noticed that it is Christmas season and that I have not been preaching Christmas messages. I just have continued to waltz our way through Romans, and I think that's appropriate, and I think that's what we need to do. As I thought about this particular section of Romans, I realized that possibly one of the best analogies for this section. One of the best Bible stories that explains this section is a Christmas story. And it's a story that you're probably not going to want me to tell. Because, well, it's probably going to ruin your picture of Christmas. You see, we sing this little song, "We Three Kings of Orient Are, Bear Gifts We Traverse Far." This morning, we sang about the three wise men who came seeking truth. I really hate to have to be the one to break this to you. I'm not talking about Santa Claus. Don't worry, we'll talk about that another day. There were three of them, and they weren't kings. I'm sorry, somebody had to tell you. And one more thing. You know those little nativity sets you got in your house? Little baby Jesus lying in a little ceramic manger with Mary being all angelic looking and Joseph standing there with his shepherd rod, even though Joseph wasn't a shepherd. And there's the other shepherds, and there's the sheep and the cow, and who knows how many, the giraffe, who knows what animals are part of your nativity set. But then also, in your nativity set, there's at least one animal who is laden with gifts, and three well-dressed men that are the kings. They weren't there. They weren't there at the nativity. They didn't come there. I mean, Jesus was involved anyway. But I'm sorry. I know I'm just totally ruining everything you know about Christmas. But I want you to understand who these guys were. There were not three of them. They were not kings. They were what we might call magi. That's the term we use where we get the word magician. But they weren't illusionists, and they weren't fortune tellers, and they didn't do card tricks. The term wise men actually is not a bad term for them, because that's what they were wise men. The magi, as we know them, were really becoming into an important group back in the old kingdom of Babylon. Matter of fact, Nebuchadnezzar was the one who made the magi really into something. As Nebuchadnezzar went and conquered peoples, he took out of those people groups the best and the brightest of the people groups. The most attractive, the most intelligent, the most wise, and the most learned of those various people groups that he conquered. He left everybody else back in the land that he conquered, but he took those important people and he told them to gather together your important writings and bring them with you and come to Babylon, because Nebuchadnezzar said, I am going to assemble a group of the wisest, smartest, most intelligent, best educated men that have ever lived on the planet to be my advisors. And so from all around the various known world, there were people who came together, and they lived there sequestered in Babylon, and they just studied all the time. They studied all of their ancient texts and all of their ancient writings, and then they also studied science. They studied biology and geology. Oh, not with some really bad scholastic textbooks, but the way you're supposed to study science is by observing things. By seeing how things work, and they were incredibly learned, incredibly wise people. The first time we're really introduced to the Magi is in the book of Daniel. Remember the book of Daniel? Daniel was about 14 years old in 607 BC when Nebuchadnezzar conquered Jerusalem. When he came into Jerusalem, he said, I want 70 of your best and brightest, your strongest, your smartest, your most intelligent young men. And Daniel was one of those guys, along with four of his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. You know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And Daniel, they got together. Yes, Rachak, and Abednego. They got together, and they took with them to Babylon the best of the texts of the Hebrews. They took with them the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament. They took with them the Israelite history up to that time, which would have been written by the prophet Samuel. They took with them some of the prophecies, some of the books of the prophets. Jeremiah, we know for a fact they had the writings of Jeremiah. Interesting, because Jeremiah was contemporary of Daniel. He was a generation ahead. They probably knew each other. They took along with them the writings of Isaiah, it would seem, and some of the other prophets, maybe Amos and Joel, possibly Jonah.
Some of the other prophets from Israel and Judah that had existed during times and written things, as well as many other of the important writings of the Jews, they took those with them back to Babylon. Now, you remember the story of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, right? Very briefly, he had a dream and scared him. He called all his magi together, and he said, "Don't mind dreaming the interpretation, nobody can do it." Well, there was a young man who was not a magi yet, but was training to become one by the name of Daniel. Who said, "I can do it?" Well, actually not me, but the God I know can do it. And he appeared before Nebuchadnezzar, and he told him the dream. Remember that? And so Nebuchadnezzar made Daniel the chief of the magicians. He became the head magi at probably 17 years old. Think about that. Hundreds of men from all around the world, wise beyond wise, many of them older men, and here's Daniel at about 17 years old, he's now their leader. What did Daniel do with them? He taught them. He taught them the Hebrew Scriptures. Because that's what he had, and that's what he knew, and that's what had made him wise. And then he began to teach them Jeremiah and Isaiah. He taught them through the Torah. He taught them the Bible. And they added that into their knowledge. Now, I told you that they like to observe things. One of the things that these magicians observed a lot was the skies above. They observed the sun and the moon and the stars, the movements of the sun and the moon and the stars, and they were extremely bright, and they were extremely smart, and they figured out that the universe moves like a giant clock, that you can quite literally set your watch by it. They figured that out all those years ago. They planned it out. They figured it out. They saw how things moved. They made predictions based on it. They actually became known as the men who understood the times. They understood the times of men. They knew when nations were going to rise and fall and when kings were going to rise and fall. And the reason was because they studied science. They studied anthropology. They studied sociology. They knew psychology. They understood men. They understood people. And they understood what was going on around people. And they were able to make some brilliant deductions. They were very smart guys. Now, fast forward a few years. About 500 years. Daniel's long gone. Matter of fact, there are no Jews left in the Magi at that point. The nation of Babylon has risen and fallen. The nation of the Medes and Persians has risen and fallen. During the empire of the Seleucids, the Magi kind of moved out on their own. They built communities and sequestered themselves to protect themselves from these coming and goings of various empires. They became known as kingmakers. If you wanted to be king, you went to the magical magic and come to you. They were too important. They were too wise. They were too learned. They were too valuable. They didn't leave their sequestered community. But if you wanted to be crowned king, you went to the magi. And if the magi understood the times and felt that you were the right man for the job, well, then they would say, yes, you can be king. They were sought out for their wisdom and their knowledge and their scientific understanding. And in many parts of the world, they were legendary. I mean, like people thought they were legends. A few people had seen the Magi. A few people had been near the Magi. But most people just heard about them. They're bedtime stories material. These guys are something else. Otherworldly, you see. They were looking at the stars, examining the movement of the stars. And they saw something about 500 years after Daniel that they had never seen before. And honestly, that humanity has never seen since. We have some amazing computer programs that we can use since the universe works like a clock, that we can use to go and see the positions of stars and planets and stuff like that from the vantage point of anywhere on the Earth at any time. Absolutely fantastic. And we can actually roll the clock back, the clock of the universe, back with these computer programs to about 4 BC. And this is amazing stuff. And we can see planets and stars align in an incredible way that they never did before and that they will never do since. Now, names of the planets and stars and stuff were pretty well established at that time, and basically the same things that we use now. And as the Magi sat there looking at the sky and seeing this thing come together that they had never seen before, they begin to understand, based on the names of the stars and the constellations that they had, and the understandings that they had, they begin to see that something amazing and fantastic was happening. And the thing that was amazing and fantastic was that the God of the heavens, That's what they called the Hebrew God.
Daniel said he's the God of the earth, the sky, and the sea, and everything in them.
And the Magi said he's the God of the heavens. The God of the heavens, they said, is having a son. And this son will be king.
Oh, not just a king like the crown when they come to us.
He will be the king of kings.
He will be the king of all there is. They saw this happening in the sky, and they went through their minds all the things that they learned, and they referred themselves back in their minds to the ancient Hebrew scriptures. Listen, I'm not making it up, this is historical fact. They turned themselves back in their mind to the ancient Hebrew scriptures and started opening up Isaiah and Jeremiah and the other scriptures they had. They opened up the books of the Torah and looked back through them, and they realized that what was happening in the sky lined up with what God said that he would do when he sent the Messiah, his anointed one, his chosen one, to be king of all kings and king of all lands and redeem all peoples. They saw it there in the text, they saw it in the sky. They knew it to be true, and so they did something they had never, ever done in the history of the Magi. They went on a trip.
I know we like to think of three well-dressed men and camels walking across the desert.
That's not what it looked like. Most historians say there were at least 200 Magi on this trip.
Could have been more.
And that they took with them servants, each Magi had personal servants, plus they had servants for the camels, servants for the goods.
So we're talking thousands.
And they didn't just have camels. The Magi themselves probably had donkeys. That was the popular thing to ride on during this period in that part of the world.
As well as a number of other animals.
They took along supplies with them enough for a roughly 18-month journey.
9 months there, 9 months back.
It was a huge caravan.
Also, the Magi had their own soldiers.
They took an army too.
I just need a picture for a moment.
This is not three kings quietly making their way to sleep in Jerusalem. As a matter of fact, when the Magi got to Jerusalem, it was one of the biggest cosmopolitan cities in that part of the Middle East at that time.
Herod had invested greatly in building it up.
It was the center of trade for that part of the Middle East.
It was the center of trade for the Eastern Roman Empire.
It was a big deal, that area geographically at that time.
And Jerusalem was amazing.
It was brilliant white limestone.
They say that you could see it for over a mile away.
Jerusalem, upon a hill, the sun shining on it.
Imagine being in Jerusalem.
You have heard legends about the Magi.
You're not sure if they exist or not.
Oh, your friend back there says he knows a guy named a guy who once saw them.
And as you look off in the distance, you see the caravan coming. It's unlike anything that you've seen before.
It's an Eastern caravan, not from within the Roman Empire.
That's weird enough in itself. It's bright, incredibly bright colors.
Soldiers with shields and strange curved swords.
Thousands of people.
It looks like it's miles long from your vantage point.
As they begin to come into Jerusalem.
The closer they come, the more you realize they're coming straight into the city.
Jerusalem was a strange city at that time in that it didn't have its own king.
There was a ruler, it was a capital city, right? But there was no ruler in Jerusalem.
Oh, there was King Herod.
Now listen, King Herod wasn't a king. Let's just settle that real quick.
First of all, King Herod was an appointed governor.
He was an appointed governor by the Roman Empire.
And he said, if you're an appointed governor, I want you to call me by the title king.
And they said, okay, fine, King Herod, whatever, just go do your job.
Now, he was very effective for the Romans.
But he was not a king.
And the other thing is, King Herod was Jewish. King Herod was Idumean, so he had no right to be a king over the Jewish people, so he wasn't dumb enough to build a palace in Jerusalem. He knew that they'd run him out. His palace was up in Caesarea. He would come down to Jerusalem for various events, but there was no king in that city. The only army in that city was the temple guard and the Romans that were kept at the fortress Antonia. And in the middle of this, here comes this huge caravan of thousands of people with their own army, with camel after camel after camel. They didn't just have three gifts of people, they were loaded down with wealth. Can you imagine the buzz and the stir that's happening in Jerusalem as these people come into Jerusalem? They come into Jerusalem, Herod's not there, he's in Caesarea. The only one who could properly receive these envoys, of course, is the highest ranking person in the region. And so Herod comes down from Caesarea, likely took a day or two to make this happen. He comes down from Caesarea and meets with them and brings them into a banquet hall and likely throws the biggest banquet he can for these magi because they are the most important people to ever visit that city during the Roman period. He is convinced they are the most important people he'll ever meet in his life. And you know what he's thinking? They have come to crown him king. Because that's what they do. Unlike all the kings before, they came to me. I would king of all the Romans. You know what he's thinking at? Herod was a horrible little man. He's only about this tall. He was extremely brutal. He was so jealous of his throne that he killed four of his sons and his wife because he thought they were trying to take his rulership away from him. Horrible little man. I got lots of stories about Herod. They come in, Herod receives them, has a big banquet, whatever. But the following day, or maybe the following week, or maybe even the following month, they finally get down to business. Herod says, tell me why you come. And they said, we come for the king. And Herod said, yeah, that's good. Let's get it on. They said, no, you understand. We've come for the Jewish king. The one who was born to be king of kings. The one who is the king that was given by the God of heavens. We've come for that king. You see, he says, we saw his star. We've been looking in the sky and we saw the movement of the stars up there, the way that things came together, and we realized that it's the truth that he's been born, and we have come to our Bible says worship him. Quite literally, they came to crown him king on earth. They came to crown him not only king, but king of kings. They're the king makers. Herod says, tell me more about this king. And they explain their position and how they knew what they knew. And he says, Oh, yes, of course I know about the king of kings. Of course I said, oh, I too have been looking for the king of kings, he says. He says, I'll find out where he is for you. You'd expect him to be born in Jerusalem. I mean, it is the capital of the city. But nobody there was aware. As quickly as he could, Herod assembled the scribes and the rabbis. We've talked a lot about the scribes and the rabbis. These guys were also incredibly smart. I don't want you to downplay how smart the scribes and the rabbis were. These guys had the Old Testament memorized, okay? And you can say anything you want about the Old Testament, and they can pull out chapter and verse, and they quote for you commentaries, entire commentaries on that topic. They could apply anything you wanted to anything you wanted. These guys were brilliant. Not only that, they too studied the sciences. They too understood anthropology, sociology, psychology, all those anthropologies. And they too watched the stars. Because the concept that the stars are God's timepiece, God's clock, that comes from the Hebrews. That's way back in Genesis. They're the ones who started this. They had been looking at the stars themselves. They saw this brilliant thing happen in the sky that had never happened before and will never happen. The scribes and the teachers of the law saw all that. They had the Old Testament memorized. Not only did they have the prophets and the Torah that the Magi had, they had the whole thing. They had books the Magi hadn't even heard of. These guys were brilliant. They were the wisest and the smartest and the best educated Hebrews ever. And so Herod called them together and he said, tell me, he said, where is the one who will be born King of the Jews, King of Kings, the anointed one of God? What does Scripture say about him? And they didn't have to think about it. They didn't have to Google it. They didn't have to go and look it up. They just knew. Bethlehem. Micah 5:2. They just rattled it off and quoted it for Bethlehem. Oh, even though you're small among the clans of Judah, one will come from you, ruler of all Israel. His origin is from antiquity, from ancient times. They just knew. Bethlehem. Herod excuses them, has another magi, calls them together. Says, by the way, I've been talking to my own wise men. And they know something you don't. That king you're talking about. He's been born in Bethlehem. The next day, the magi set up in Bethlehem. I want you to understand, Bethlehem is 7 miles from Jerusalem. The average human, when they're walking slowly, walks 2 miles an hour. That means you can leave Jerusalem after breakfast and be there by lunch. This was not a long ways away. They probably traveled faster than that caravan, and they traveled close to 4 miles an hour. They went from Jerusalem to Bethlehem in another 2 hours. This was not far away. It wasn't like they had to refigure and get other compasses and look for the star. Bethlehem, that's just down the road. With the weather right, some say you can actually see Bethlehem from Jerusalem. It's just not that far. Seven miles they go. They get down to Bethlehem. It was a little village at the time, between 200 and 300 people. Now it's got about 70,000 people, but at the time it was between 200 and 300 people, and it was just a workers' village. Just a place where a better community for workers. Seems that Herod had this place he was building about 4 miles from them. This is where certain group of family members came from David's line, workers, this is where they housed. It just wasn't much. When the Magi got to Bethlehem, they did not find baby Jesus lying in a manger with sheep. What they found was a toddler. Matthew makes that very clear. He uses the word that we would say toddler. About a year and a half old or so. Walking, but probably not talking too much. They found him with his mom at home. It was the middle of the day. Dad was at work. And there they crowned him king over all there is. They indicated that he was king. Imagine what the neighbors thought. Imagine the thousands of people in this brilliant, bright caravan coming into muddy, dusty Bethlehem, stopping at the house that Mary and Joseph were renting, bringing Jesus out before them, bowing before this little toddler with slobbering sticky fingers, and crowning him king over all of the world. Incredible scene. Here's the thing that shocks me about it. No scribes or rabbis. I want you to think about that for just a minute. The scribes and the rabbis saw the exact same thing that this guy with the Magi saw and interpreted it in a very similar fashion. The scribes and the rabbis not only had the writings of the Magi, they had even more. They had much more information at their fingertips than the Magi ever could have. They understood much more about the coming King of Kings than the Magi ever could have. 7 miles away from the headquarters of the rabbis, baby Jesus is born, and they don't notice. The Magi, 9 months away. They've got to march for 9 months. They see it. They understand. They come. The rabbis, the scribes, the people who have the Old Testament memorized, the people who invented the concepts of astrology that we use today when we're talking astronomy. They invented this stuff. They knew this stuff. They could rattle it off without even thinking about it. And yet, they couldn't be bothered to go 7 miles to see if this was true. Does that just strike you as odd? Just a little bit? It should. They had all the information, and they didn't go.
It's striking was odd until you really start to think about things. Because I have known a lot of Christian people in my life. I would say the majority of the people that I have known growing up in profession were claiming in some way or another to be Christian people. And I have known a lot of church people in my life, people who are faithful church members, who give, who are leaders, who are involved in district leadership, who are supporting missionaries and church plants. I have known a lot of church people in my life. And the vast majority of church people that I have known are just like those scribes. They are loaded with information. They have tons of information. They know a lot of stuff. They can grab off chapter and verse for you about just about anything. They can read the newspaper and say, look in the book of the Revelation and cross-reference, and I can understand what's going on. But when God starts to do a mighty and innocent thing in their midst, they miss it. They have all of the information, but they don't have any inspiration. Just like the scribes. Paul says this. So then, brothers and sisters, we're not obligated in flesh, because if you look in flesh, you're going to die. I hope you watched the Wednesday Bible study. This will make a lot more sense for you if you include it in the Wednesday study. You were here on Wednesday night. We talk about the fact that people are triune to a great extent. We're three-part being. We have body, mind, and spirit. Body, flesh, mind, your mind, literally who you are, your soul, your personality, mind, and spirit. The part of you that's eternal that connects with God. We talked about this on Wednesday. We talked about the fact that the flesh and the spirit are battling for control of your mind. We talked about how the world and the forces of the evil one are all on the side of your flesh to get control of your mind. We talked about that. And we talked about the fact that if we live according to flesh, we're not. If we allow the flesh, and I do mean our literal bodies, to have control of our minds and determine what we're going to do and how we're going to live, And the choices that we make, we're going to die. Because if the body's going to die, we know that. And if the body's in control of the mind, see you later. But Paul says, if we live by the Spirit, if by the Spirit we put to death the deeds of the body, that doesn't mean the bad things the body does. That means how Paul talked about the old man of our nature, calling out to you and saying, come do what I'm telling you to do. If by the Spirit we put that to death, render powerless, chapter 6. If we do that, then we will live. Now, I know an awful lot of Christians who are stuck in Romans chapter 7, we talked about this last week, you're going to have to do some review, who are trying to fight off the flesh. The flesh is saying, do this, and they're saying, I'm not going to. And the reason is because they're trying to tell the flesh to shut up by themselves. But the flesh is in control of the mind. It doesn't work. But by the Spirit. If the Spirit of God in you tells the flesh to shut up. I told you about our dog, our little dog that is a puppy that's too big. He's a Malinois. Wendy tells him to sit, he's like, I'm sorry, I don't understand English. Wendy says, get in the house. See if you can get in the house. He's like, yeah, I'm busy, whatever. When I say to him, you sit. I don't even need to talk to him. Down he goes. I don't know why. That's just what he's chosen to do. Good example. You tell the flesh,
you quit bothering me, I'm going to be good now.
Whatever. But the Spirit of God says, that's enough. Gone. You see, for all those led by God's Spirit are God's children. You didn't receive the slavery, fall back to fear. In other words, you're no longer enslaved to that thing. You're not afraid of doing the wrong thing. Instead, you're seeking to serve God, adoption by looking all out of the Father. I told you the example that I heard from Bill Ritchie, the pastor of Crossroads Community Church, many years ago. He was a guy who went to Israel often. He was in Israel in Tel Aviv many years ago, back when malls were a big thing. And there was a family there who had gone shopping. And they had a little girl who apparently was prone to get distracted by all of the things there in shops. You know, want to stop and look at everything. And apparently they had told her, don't do that. There's many people here. It's a big mall. You're going to get lost. You just stay with your dad and you'll be fine. What do you expect? I mean, she didn't listen.
John talks about the lust of the eyes, desire of the flesh, desire for what we have undone. Those things drug her away, walking down the hall pretty soon. She's veering off and going into a shop somewhere, going into a store and seeing things, and then all of a sudden she realized she was not with her dad. She was alone. She was lost. Her dad knew she was lost too. He was in the hallway just waiting for her. He knew she was lost. He knew where she was. He was waiting for her. Bill said she came out of the store and she screamed, "Abba!" And he got down on his knees like this. And she just came running and jumped in his arms and he picked her up and she said over and over in his ear, "Abba." That's what this means. We have received that kind of adoption. We've been led away by the world. We've been distracted by the things of the world. We've wandered off and suddenly we realize we're alone and we're lost. And so we call out to him, "Abba." And he says, "I'm right here." And we come running and he picks us up. And we say, "Abba, Father." This is what Paul is saying. Like we talked about Wednesday, we are at home with him. We are comfortable with him. Paul says the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. We talked about that on Wednesday as well. The fact that it is the spiritual side of us that connects with God. His spirit speaks to our spirit. If our spirit is in control of our mind, then we hear from God. If our flesh is in control of our mind, the spirit of the dark spirit will be all your things, see? The spirit himself testifies together with our spirit that we are his children, and if we're children, we're heirs, we have received the sonship of God. This is what Paul is talking about here in Romans. And this is what is so brilliantly displayed in the story of the Magi. Don't you understand?
The Magi didn't have all the information. The Magi didn't follow all the rules of Jewish law. They didn't do the sacrifices and the ceremonies, wear the right clothes, and eat the right food. They were Eastern people. They looked a lot more Persian than they did Jewish. Matter of fact, as far as we know, at this particular point in history, there was not a single Jew in their group. But, they took God at his word. They believed what he had said. And when he started doing something fantastic and magnificent, they said, "I'll go." And off they went because they wanted to be with him. They were seeking to know God. And because they were seeking to know God, and because they humbled themselves, left their home. They humbled themselves. They set aside the desires of their flesh, and then instead they said, "The Spirit is so much more important to me. I've got to know God. I've got to understand God. I've got to connect with God." Oh, I'm sure there are many who said, "I don't think they should go on that trip. That's a waste of time. That's a waste of funds. If he wants to be king, he can come to me." No, they said, they set that all aside and said, "We believe what God has said in the scriptures. We see what God has done in the sky, and so we are going to set all of that behind. And we're going to go with him." And as a result, they heard from his spirit. You see, not the rabbis and scribes. The reason the rabbis and scribes were religious was to satisfy the desires of the flesh. That's how you got ahead in that community, by being religious. I heard an interview with some former NFL quarterbacks, two of whom were deeply committed Christians, and one of whom was a deeply committed heathen. And they all ended up on the same team together, and the deeply committed heathen realized that the deeply committed Christians had been in the NFL all the time, and that doesn't normally happen. NFL means not for long. You're only in there a while, and then you're out. But this guy saw that these two guys had been in a long time, so he felt a lot better to become a Christian too, because maybe that's the key to being in the NFL a long time. That was the scribes and the Pharisees. They were saying, "Well, we're just going to follow all this religious stuff because it makes us important, it makes us money, it gives us a place to live, it gives us a job to do, it's very valuable in the community, it makes us really important." I knew a man who had gone to church continuously, who was a member of the Church of Nazarene, who worked with the district very closely, who gave vast sums of his wealth to the church and all this other kind of stuff, and never knew Christ. And the reason was because he said, "This is a really good way to get ahead in the community."
And there are a lot of Christians who come every Sunday
morning for that reason.
Just like the scribes and Pharisees, because it's what we're supposed to do, and maybe if I do what I'm supposed to do long enough, then I'll end up in heaven one day. And in the meantime, people in the community will think more highly of me because I'm a church member. My kids will think I'm a better dad or mom because I make them go to church. Or whatever it is. You see, what the Magi had is inspiration from the Spirit. What the rabbis had is information on page. And so when God started doing something fantastic in their midst, they didn't see it. Because the thing God was doing was a deeply spiritual, amazingly powerful thing. It was His Spirit talking to the hearts of men, and their hearts couldn't listen because their hearts were only for the flesh. You understand? Okay, I know I'm going a long time, but let me give you one more quick story. It will all make sense, and we'll be done. Over in Acts chapter 19, there's another really good example of this. Paul rolls into Ephesus. Great city, big city, he wants to plant a church. Unlike all of the other places where he's gone throughout his travels, he has something really special happen when he gets to Ephesus. He meets disciples, 12 of them. Disciples! This doesn't normally happen. Normally he comes into the church from scratch and he's heard anything about Jesus. He gets to Ephesus. There are 12 men there who are trying to be like Jesus. That's what he means to be a disciple. They're trying to be like Jesus. They have heard about Jesus. They heard the preaching of John the Baptist about Jesus. They likely had heard from Jesus himself. They heard about how Jesus had died and how he was buried and how he rose again to bring them life. And they want to be like Jesus. And so they're doing everything they can to be like Jesus. It's great! Can you imagine if you're going to go try to plant a church, you get 12 people in the community who are excited that you're there trying to plant a church because they're trying to be like Jesus? How wonderful this is! How fantastic this is! So Paul began hanging out with them and began teaching them and watching their lives and then observing them, and he noticed something that really interested him. They were doing everything they could to be like Jesus. They were doing everything they could to tell the flesh to shut up now in this very immoral community. Tell the flesh to shut up, we're going to be good now. They were doing everything they could to be good church people, to do all the right stuff, and none of it was working. There was no fruit, no love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, none of that broke again. And if these guys are so excited about knowing about Jesus, there were no new believers. They were going to work each day, and nobody was saying, tell me about your whole Christian thing, because you're different than other people. Paul says this is wrong. And so after hanging out with them for a while and talking to them for a while and trying to figure out what the deal was, he finally stumbled onto something. He asked them one day, listen, did you guys receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they said, literal translation, Holy Spirit, never heard of the guy. Paul says, oh, that's the problem. He said, wait a minute, you got all baptized, right? Oh, yeah, they said, you're baptized in the believers? He said, tell me about your baptism. They said, you're baptized by John the Baptist himself. Oh, Paul said, that's the thing. John the Baptist baptizes for repentance. In other words, you acknowledge that you had gone the way of the world and then weren't going to go that way anymore. You wanted to go a new way, so John the Baptist baptized you. The problem is, he only baptized you out of the world. He didn't really baptize you into anything. You need to be baptized into the name of Christ, you see. And when you're baptized into the name of Christ, that is, you like the Magi do, and say, I'm going to humble myself, I'm going to set aside the desires of the flesh, I'm going to set aside the things I'm trying to accomplish in life, I'm going to set aside my own majesty, and instead I'm going to go seek after Christ, so I can bow before Him and say, you are the King of all there is. When you do that, you see, This amazing thing happens. Jesus says, you're born again. You're born anew. You're born from above. You're born of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes and awakens your spirit and makes your spirit alive. And then when the Holy Spirit speaks, you can hear. And when the Holy Spirit empowers, you're empowered. And it's no more you telling the flesh to lead on. Instead, it's the Holy Spirit of God saying, enough of that. This one is mine. He's my child. Remember what Jesus said in John 14? He said, I used to call you servants. I don't call you servants anymore.
Now I call you friends. We don't understand that term friends. You know, in the song says there's friends, closer brother. That's a little more like the idea. I call you friends. People who are so close to me, you know everything about me and what kind of underwear I wear. He says, I call you friends because you understand the Father's business.
Because when the Father speaks, you hear, you see. That's what happens if you've been baptized out of trying to do bad, but you haven't been baptized in to Christ. You haven't received the Holy Spirit. And they say, no, we need that. Because we've been going to church a long time, I recall, and it hasn't changed in my life. And the struggles I used to have, I'm still having. And the things I know I should do, I'm still doing. And my marriage isn't getting any better. My kids aren't benefiting in any. Nobody's changing down at work. And I'm just not the kind of person that I believe wants me to be. I know I'm not the kind of person that I want to be because of what Paul said, I'm sure. I'm not at home with him. I can't just dwell with him. I can't just rest with him. I've always got to try to be better, try to do good. And I'm almost kind of afraid of him. Paul said, all right, let's get baptized into the name of Christ. The only proper response at this point is for me to ask you, of course, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believe? Because I tell you what, God is doing some amazing, incredible things in these days, like we have never seen before. He is writing in the sky and all around us in our church. He's doing some incredible things. And he keeps telling me, just hold on, it's all coming. It's fantastic what he's doing in our hearts and minds. And I'm seeing some of you just take off and grow and dig in and deep. I remember hearing the guy at Chris's funeral, never been over it. He stood up and said, Chris was really in this whole Christian vibe, and now I can see it. He's doing some incredible and amazing things in us. And some of us are just, well, I know all the information. Ain't nothing that you can tell me in that Bible picture. I've heard it before. I know it all. Been hanging around the church all the time. Maybe you got baptized out of being bad on purpose. But you haven't gotten baptized in to the Holy Spirit, who will come and awaken your heart to your spirit, and you can hear his voice, and you can be transformed. Paul says we're transformed by the renewing of our minds. The renewing of our minds comes from the Holy Spirit renewing our minds. Not from reading more stuff, getting more information. It comes from inspiration. So the choice is yours. You can continue to describe it, Rabbi. I think they're pretty important people. Everybody like them. Or you can say you want to be a magi, somebody weird and outside of the whole thing, but who has the Spirit of God. Let's take a couple minutes and we'll pray. I wasn't necessarily planning on it, but I think we're going to go ahead and allow you to just come and bow at the altar. And there's a reason for that. And the reason for that is because if you are going to set aside the things of the flesh and to be filled with things of the Spirit, it really helps if you can literally set aside the things of the flesh. And nobody likes coming up here because everybody sees and it's embarrassing. And besides, things are uncomfortable. And they're all going to think I did some horrible thing last night. And no, just, you got to be able to say, listen, it's much more important to me not what anybody thinks, not how uncomfortable it is, not how weird it is. It's much more important to me to simply be touched by the Spirit. And so I'm going to go ahead and come and say, Lord, I need you to make my Spirit alive. So let's pray, and let's all keep our eyes closed, unless it's bush walking, and then you'll probably want to open them. And come and pray. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you have given us an opportunity to be set free. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us the opportunity to be filled with the Spirit. To not have to try to struggle with life, try to be good enough, and try to understand it all on our own. We thank you, Lord, that you have offered us inspiration that we can be filled with. How I pray, Lord, that you will make our spirits alive before you. And that you, O Lord, will whisper in our ears that we are your children.
And then we will cling to you and cry out, Abba. We have come to crown you, King, Lord. King of our lives, our hearts, families, all we are. We surrender ourselves to you today, O God. I want to be filled with you. Come and touch us and fill us with prayer, Jesus.
Magnifies the Lord, my soul. Magnifies the Lord.
and rest to you. And this week, as we do all of our Christmas preparations and gather with family and these things, Lord, that you will be forefront in our heart and our mind, and we will find ourselves not trying to please you, but comfortable with you as you change us and make us into just what you can do. How we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.